And first question I'll take off here. I'm sorry if I have to diddle around with my glasses because they're a bit distant enough already. Here's a tricky one to start for you, Prime Minister. In adventure sports, what does BMX stand for?
Sorry, BMX.
BMX.
No, BMW stands for.
Are there any motocross? I don't know. To be honest, I don't know. Whoever asked that question, no.
Bicycle motocross.
Bicycle motocross, thank you very much. Speaking of BMWs, how many do you actually have, Prime Minister?
Well, one less after tonight. I jumped on the roof of it.
Yes, there was a little bit of damage to that one. I think we'll come out of the tax. Okay, so, gentlemen with the microphones, do we have down here on the floor, we have a question, please. So if you would mark, Alan, the gentleman in front, please, I can see you, sir. Microphone's coming your way.
With the economy, one of the biggest things seems to be is the ability to connect at high levels. I am amazed at the last 40 years out of it, the last few months, how well connected this country, and you in the United States with Joe Biden and Barack Obama, Tim Gross had been invited to a special meeting in Beijing, for instance. Peter Townsend coming back saying we need now to be not the little brother of Australia, but related to China independently on our own feet. Now, therefore, I would like to make a suggestion. I could talk about Canterbury, but that's another story. What about Wellington? What do you think of the idea of connecting with a sister relationship through Wellington, Beijing, and also Wellington, Washington? Include sister schools, school-to-school relationships, include business-chamber relationships, possibly city officials, all sorts of, add computer, so the kids are in touch class-to-class through email and other computer means. Now, New Zealand could become extremely well-connected if it started to use computers through this way in various sister city constructions. So would you like to think about Wellington connecting in this way, in city of triangulation? Maybe also throw in a developing nation area, maybe a capital of Samoa or something like that. So you're getting a three-way perspective on developing nations. There's a lot of things developing nations will need that come from these others. We could triangulate a lot of that.
Yeah. I guess we tended to think that sister relationships would occur at the local government level, and they certainly have. So, for instance, Christchurch will have a sister relationship in China, and I think probably in Japan and a number of other countries. That doesn't mean that we couldn't look to explore that at a government level. What we've tended to do at a government level is support higher level forums. So, for instance, the New Zealand-US Partnership, Business Partnership Forum is an example. But, you know, to your wider point, if I could just make one point about that, and that is, look, a hugely important part, if New Zealand is going to do better, we have to sell more to the world than we buy from it. So to give you an example of why that's a problem, since about 2003, we have been buying more from the world than we've been selling to it. So we've actually been in a recession from the export point of view for a long period of time. Some of the things that we've done that really helped, I think, are things like free trade agreements. So the previous Labor government actually signed up the free trade agreement with China. We supported that in opposition, and we pushed that program in government with Malaysia and the Gulf states and others. But just to give you an example of how successful that has been, two-way trade between New Zealand and China was up 62% last year. It's now $10 billion. China's our second largest market. So we've got an explosion happening of growth because of these FTAs. But where I don't think we're doing a good enough job, and where I think the government can take some responsibility and do some work with the local chambers and the likes, is actually having a strategy for China. It's one thing to have an FTA, it's another thing to have a strategy. So let me give you one example of how we're not that well connected. In 2009, that was the first year in New Zealand's history that more kids at school learned Mandarin than Latin. And if we're serious about China, then we've got to be learning Mandarin, Cantonese, how to communicate.
Rob, I can't see you up there. Do you have a question at this point? If people can start putting their hands up, perhaps along here, and we'll get a microphone down to you, and then I'll take one off the screen while we're waiting for that. In anticipation of their future revenue, will the government invest in Canterbury's water infrastructure?
Simple answer is yes. So if we go back to, I think I made very similar comments when I was here last year, and if we go back to what we're trying to do here, we have huge respect for the environmental responsibility we have. So I know that some people will challenge that, but we really do. I think what's actually happening and has been one of the issues with not having an operative plan for 19 years in Christchurch has meant that we've actually been putting huge environmental pressure, actually, on the water table in Christchurch. We've been sucking a lot of water out on a first-comes, first-served basis, while 97% of all rain that falls on the South Island washes out to sea. So I think we can collect water. I think we can use it to irrigate more of the South Island and make a lot more money. And I think we can do it in a way which takes pressure off the environment from a water perspective. And the Land and Water Forum, which we support and which is well serviced by a number of groups, environmentalists and feed farmers and economic development agencies, are in support of that. But what I would say is that while largely the cost of that is going to fall on those who want to use it, electricity companies, people who want to irrigate the land, it's probably unlikely we'll get the sort of things we want going unless the government's prepared to step up and put some cash in. It might lend cash or it might put some money in, but I think you are going to see us have to put our hands in our pocket.
David, I'll come to you and then Rob, I'll go on top.
My name's Evelyn Hilly and this is Melissa Fox. I've been a long-term foster parent for Melissa. Melissa left school at the end of last year, during which time she was a transition student and undertook various work placements. In the transition process, we approached lots of different centres throughout Christchurch. The only one that was able to continue sending her to a work placement with a one-on-one carer, which she needs for a fulfilment of her whole experience of life, was the Chris Ruth Centre. The other centres were not able to provide any support for Melissa to continue through all the experiences that she'd had through the transition. She now goes to the Chris Ruth Centre for only 2.5 days a week. Most of the other students are there full time because there has been a change in funding in recent years. What commitment does your government have to support Melissa for 5 days a week on a one-to-one situation in a daycare centre, such as the Chris Ruth Centre, and it is the only one in Christchurch? And did you put anything in the budget for young people like Melissa?
Okay, so you raise a very important point around disabled New Zealanders that need support and help. So I think the answer is yes, there was more money that went into the budget overall. I can't tell you exactly how much, and we've gone through the Ministry of Health vote, which is normally where it goes. I can't tell you exactly, you know, why she can't get 5 days funding. I'd have to go and look at the individual case. But what I can say to you is if you can go to one of the local MPs and have the case brought up with them, then I can go and personally have a look at it for you. So I don't know who your local... So where are you? Okay, if you go back, go pick one of the national MPs, I'll know them. That doesn't mean I like them, it just means I know them. Go and see one of them and I'll go and have a look at the individual case. But your essential point is that we would agree with, which is we want to give people the best opportunities they can, and clearly for New Zealanders that need extra help, as is the situation with your daughter or something, is it? Then we need to work our way through that. And I'll just have to go and look at it.
If one of those three MPs that you've already seen as a national, I'd go back to that one.
Go back to them and just...
I'll be moving very swiftly after this evening. Up to the gongs, do we have a question from up top, please?
We're at the centre.
Prime Minister, how can you justify the overthrowing of Canterbury water conservation orders?
Right, so let me explain that, and that is that, because you're right, there has been a change in Canterbury compared to the rest of the country. So the rest of the country had what was called the underlying principle behind a water conservation order was preservation, and in Canterbury we changed that to be sustainable. And the reason was that the logical flow is for there to be a water plan and for that to basically inform your water conservation orders. But because Canterbury had no operative plan, you essentially brought in water conservation orders before you had an operative plan. And so what we've done is we've said, look, we need to get an operative plan, and we actually need to get water conservation orders, which are in tune with both the environment and the economic objectives we have. And on that basis, we've gone away and said, let's have a moratorium on everything that we're doing. Let's allow the commissioners to go out and do their work. And you've got to say, given they've been reducing rates today, that's not a bad start for them. And let's them go away and get an operative plan and get those water conservation orders working properly. Now, what the long-term structure for Canterbury looks like, I don't know. It's possible that we'll go back to ECANS. One of the recommendations was that it was a standalone water authority in Christchurch. I don't know whether we'd support that or not. We haven't looked at it. But we do certainly want to restore ECANS to a democratic position as quickly as we can, and certainly before 2012 or the next local government election. But that's the reason for the difference in definition of the water conservation plan here.
Come over here, Alan. Do you have somebody ready to go? And I'll come over to you, David.
Prime Minister, I was just wondering, what's your personal opinion on privatisation of state-owned enterprises? Are you for or against it?
Well, as I said earlier, I'm not ideologically opposed to them. I think there can be some merit in that argument, depending on how they're done. So trade sales, as they were done in the past, I don't think were terribly effective. I don't think that they put the assets in the right hands, and I don't think that they delivered those assets to New Zealanders or at the best value. So I think the world has sort of moved on in its thinking, and a general model that's put up as being successful would be in New Zealand, where the Crown owns the majority stake, but some is floated on the stock exchange. And I think there is potentially some merit in that argument. Whether that means we're prepared to progress that for assets outside of Kiwibank is something our caucus and our cabinet just hasn't had a discussion on, nor have we looked at how much revenue we might be able to raise and what would be done with that capital. But the point that Bill English has been making, and he's got a fair point, is that the Crown balance sheet's in the order of $200 billion. And just because we've invested in something in the past doesn't necessarily, by definition, always mean the investment's in the right place. So the question is, could you move the investment around to support some areas where you want growth? So as an example, we're not going to float a bit of Kiwibank, but we know that Kiwibank needs to grow. And to do that, we need more capital. Now, maybe there's an argument that says you have a partial privatisation of a small of a piece of one asset, and you pump that money, for instance, into Kiwibank over here. That might be a logical economic argument, but we just haven't had those debates internally. But we will have them, and we'll be very unambiguous when we go to you at the end of, or sometime next year. So we'll either go and say, position remains, no asset sales for the next 3 years, or the position's changing, these are the assets and this is what it means. And very straight up.
Hi. The question I had was your initiative to roll out superfast broadband for all New Zealanders has a huge impact, which I've seen done on a local level by lots of the councils around the country so far. They're all submitting applications to Crown Fibre to be the chosen LFC for New Zealand. One of the concerns that's expressed by certainly the local council fibre delivery company down here is that your I guess the government's historic trust they seem to have with the incumbent telcos, and that perhaps default to that again, and thereby cutting out the freedom of choice that New Zealanders have got at the moment through these companies to choose their own telecommunications providers and not be dictated to by Telecom and Telstra, who have historically held everybody to ransom for years. So what guarantees do we have to say that although Crown Fibre is looking at these applications, that they'll give these companies a fair shot at being providers?
Yeah, so let's take a step back. The first thing is, the objective we have is to roll out ultra-fast broadband to 3/4 of all New Zealanders, and then at least much faster levels than you currently have, basically the bulk of other New Zealanders. And that would mean, you know, all of Christchurch. I mean, it basically means the vast bulk of cities and towns right across New Zealand. For the reasons I think you were alluding to, actually, I mean, it has such a huge economic impact on New Zealand. And I mean, just to give you an example of why I think that's really important, I just did a little video conference with Haast School a couple of weeks ago. So there was a little school. They just dialed me up. I've got ultra-fast broadband on my computer in Parliament, and I just spent half an hour talking to them about life as being Prime Minister and answering their questions. And that interactive learning capability, which they can then do with teachers, say, in Christchurch or around New Zealand, is tremendous. So I think from an education, health, commerce perspective, it's hugely powerful. Second thing is that if you think about what the future of New Zealand's going to look like, this is my view, I reckon we are going to be very strong in food production, anything ending in culture, aquaculture, horticulture, viticulture, you know, you name it. So any kind of food production, we're going to be very strong. I think tourism will be very strong. And the third area I reckon will be extremely powerful is service-based industries using the internet or manufacturing sold over the internet. So, for example, the guy that was the first investor in Facebook, right, he came to see me a few weeks ago. He's now living in New Zealand part of the time. Really interesting guy. He was telling me that, because he's on the board still, so he was at the board meeting a few weeks ago, and he said they had 500 million users of Facebook at the moment. They're going to have 630 million by the end of the year and a billion by next year. So what other device or capability do we have to reach a billion people? And the answer is on a cost-efficient basis, nothing compared to the internet. Or I'll give you another example, which is, I think, kind of interesting but bizarre. The largest meat processing plant in the world is in Mecca. Right? It's in Saudi Arabia, Mecca. It operates for 3 days a year at the Hajj, you know, where they have the festival and celebration, and they slaughter this huge number of sheep. That meat processing plant was designed, and the building of it was overseen by New Zealanders. Of itself, that's not remarkable, but this is the remarkable thing. You can only go to Mecca if you're Muslim, and these New Zealanders were not and are not, and have never been to that site. But they've designed it and overseen the construction of it all through the internet. So there's no question in my mind, capability to transform New Zealand's huge. So in answer to your question, we need to deliver the what's called the dark fibre, so in other words, that fibre that's running around New Zealand on a basis where any retailing company can hook into it. So Crown Fibre Holdings' job is to agree with these contractors around the country to roll out that fibre. And then whether your end user is Telecom or Telstra or any other user, ISP, that's their call. But everybody's got to be able to have access to that, which is essentially local loop unbundling. So Crown Fibre Holdings will definitely select partners to go and roll that out. And I don't think you can guarantee by any stretch of the imagination it'll be Telecom. I don't know who will be. They're very independent, and they'll just go out and spend the $1.5 billion we're putting in. $1.5 to $2 billion the private sector will put in, but any company, any ISP will be able to access it, so you will definitely get choice.
Question from the screen, and then I'll go up to you, Rob. You went to a state school and have highly succeeded, so why would you send your children to private school? That doesn't seem to support the state system.
Yeah, so it purely comes out of personal choice, and I think the state schools in New Zealand are tremendous. I mean, I went back to Burnside for the 50-year reunion that we had in Easter. I'm sure there's some people in the audience, but that was great. Some people had lost their hair and gained weight, and that was just the girls, let alone the boys. So, but it was great, and I had a great education there. And there are tremendous schools right across Christchurch that are public schools, but I believe in choice. And it's up to you if you want to decide. The one thing I will say is for every New Zealander that sends their child to an independent school and pays the fees, that is the one area, because it doesn't happen in health and it doesn't happen in a lot of other places, that's the one area where you are literally paying twice. Because you're actually getting no benefit from the state, virtually nil, and you have the right to send your child to that school and you are paying totally for those fees yourself. So actually, if I was the other New Zealanders who aren't going to send their kids to independent schools, I'd be cheering on any parent that decides to do that, because you're actually leaving more capability and better funding for kids that do go to private public schools. But it's just pure choice.
Up the top.
Prime Minister, if government is investing in water in Canterbury, will you just be doing that to accelerate irrigation or will you also be investing in environmental protection and restoration, given that tens of millions are going into Lakes Taupo and Rotorua to restore water quality, and we have a number of candidates for environmental restoration in Canterbury?
Yeah, so look, it's got to be a balanced approach. And as I said to you earlier, or said the group earlier, the point is the current situation delivering an environmentally sustainable condition in Christchurch? Because last time I went and had a look at it, bits of the Avon River were running dry. You know, the Waimakua area is starting to run dry in parts because there's so much pressure on the water table. In fact, there's problems in terms of the quality of water in Christchurch. So I think, personally, you can't just go and irrigate South Island to hell with the environmental concerns, because you're absolutely right, those nutrients can get into the water table, and the long-term repercussions of those, as we've found in lakes like Rotowiti and Taupo, have been significant. So you have to have a mind to that. But nor can I think you say that the current position is actually delivering you a positive environmental outcome, and we just have to make sure we do both. And I think you can actually do both, but you've got to do it in a way that's fair. And I think, love or hate it, if you look at the commissioners that we chose and put in, we tried to put in commissioners that would actually be seen by the community as being balanced and fair, and they included the, you know, former environmental judge, that included someone like Dame Margaret Baisley, who seems one of the most neutral and proficient public servants that we had.
Prime Minister, can I ask, if you have an environment protection agency, is three levels of government actually too much for New Zealand?
Well, I mean, in the end, we had to ask the question, you know, would a standalone environmental protection agency do better than having that consenting process running through the Ministry of Environment? And in the end, we decided that it was better to say, look, the Ministry of Environment should be a policy division, and the Environmental Protection Agency should be there to review submissions and to deal with issues out in the field as no one likes administration of those acts. So, yeah, I mean, we were conscious of being seen to increase the bureaucracy, and in headcount numbers we're certainly not going to, but I think a standalone strong environmental protection agency is actually better and has been welcomed by environmental groups.
Prime Minister, ACC levies increased for motorcyclists. Now, why were they singled out? I understand user pays.
Yep.
But when a high percentage of accidents are caused by car drivers or other motorists, and there's been examples of two high-profile cases with police cars doing U-turns and causing motorcyclists to crash, why just motorcyclists?
Yeah, so I don't have the exact numbers on there. I used to know them in my head really well last year, and I've obviously gone out of my head. But the long and short of it is this, that if you went purely to a user pays basis, the ACC fee for a motorbike would rise significantly greater than it did last year, so by some multiple. And the reason for that is that you may well be right, actually, that accidents are caused sometimes by the nature of driving from people in cars, and it may sometimes be the responsibility of the person driving the bike. But what is irrefutable is that if you come off a bike and you have an accident, the probability of you incurring a much greater liability to the Crown, because we have to pay for that through ACC, through loss of wages or fixing you up, is huge. So if you really looked at it, you'd be nervous about getting on a bike because of the death rate and the significant accident rate. So in the end, we were really trying to say, look, what is a fairer apportionment of those costs? And we pulled back from very significant increases. I think those big bikes were going to go from 250 to 750, and I think we took it back to 500. But there's no question that the average cost of someone involved in an accident on a bike is significantly greater. I accept that, but actually the numbers don't support your view.
Okay. Good.
Next question.
Yeah, so I tell you what, if you want to email me, I'll email you back exactly what the average person involved in an accident on a motorbike actually costs. I mean, we can have a debate about who's responsible for that, but I'm telling you now, factually, it costs a hell of a lot more, because when you get hit on a bike, you just don't have the protection you have in the car.
Question from the screen, and then I'll come over to you, David. I need an MRI scan. Christchurch Hospital waiting time 13 months. World-class healthcare looks a long way off.
Well, yeah, I don't know if I'd accept that for the reasons that I said earlier. If you go and have a look at what's been happening in terms of elective surgeries, those numbers have been coming down dramatically. And I had some numbers on your healthcare, so I'll just go and have a look at it. But so, as example, yes, 12,400 more procedures in 2008 and 14,400 more procedures in 2009 than ever before. So generally speaking, the waiting list has been coming down. Plus we're spending a lot more money, $750 million more in the southern region.
Don't know the person waiting, but hi. David, please.
Hi, Prime Minister. Yeah, quick question for you on GST.
Yeah.
I can understand the principles behind increasing GST, obviously the increased revenue that that will bring in. I can also understand that the more income you have, the more you're likely to spend, and that's, in my opinion, is beyond doubt.
Yeah.
I just have difficulty understanding the rationale behind putting GST on basic human requirements such as food, and also why I heard there was some rationale around that we weren't able to do that for administrative reasons, it was too difficult. But why are we not able to do that when lots of other Western countries can give people that break on what is a basic human necessity?
Yeah, so let me run through a few things that you covered there. So you're absolutely right. Basically, the incidence of GST, in other words, who's paying it, is very much in line with what the progressive personal tax system looks like. In other words, pretty simply, you earn $20,000 a year in the hand, you consume the whole lot, let's assume for the moment you're not paying any rent, then you're paying, you know, under the new terms, you'll pay $6,000, $3,000 in GST. You know, I earn $100,000 a year and I consume the lot, I'm going to pay five times that amount. Right, so that's effectively what's happening. So higher income earners consume a lot more, pay a lot more GST. So it's about the same distribution as you actually see on the personal tax system. So in the last budget, the magic behind it all was we delivered a $4 billion personal tax cut with a $2 billion GST increase. That was why we got up there and said early on, everyone's going to be better off, the vast bulk of people would be better off and no one would be worse off on a straight GST income tax switch. So when we raised GST from 12.5% to 15%, we raised about $2.3 billion. So if you took it off completely off food, all food, everything, it would cost $3 billion. So firstly, it would be hugely prohibitive. So very quickly, you start saying, okay, well, it doesn't make sense to take it off, you know, take away like McDonald's or Burger King, right? So then you say, okay, I'm going to take it off what I deem to be healthy food. And then very quickly you get into what is healthy food. So people start saying, well, take it off fruit and vegetables. Well, why wouldn't you take it off meat? In Australia, for instance, they took it off an uncooked chicken because they said, look, mum and dad take that home and barbecue that or cook it. But they wouldn't take it off a cooked chicken like you get from a rotisserie store, because they deem that to be a luxury. So what they do in Australia is they literally cool the chicken down to sell it without GST, right? So then you start saying, okay, this is how mad it gets when you get into hundreds of pages of administration. So then you sit there and you say, okay, let's say we just take off fruit and vegetables. So a tomato no longer has GST. What about the tomato slice that's in your Kiwi burger at McDonald's? Right? And then you start saying, okay, what do you do to the store, like Countdown, that has GST on some things and not on others? Look, the administration of it would eat up everything we'd save, and in the end, for what? So the answer is, how much do you spend on potatoes and meat and and bread and those things and milk a year or a week, let's say? And the answer is we can calculate that, what the average household spends. We can calculate the GST difference, and we'd be better just to give you the money. Administratively, a lot better to give you the money, and that's why we do it. It's just a lot easier.
Rob, going up to you. Question at the top.
Good evening, Prime Minister. My question relates to health for private medical health care.
Yep.
And the cost of that is just going through the roof, and the older you get, the faster it's going up. And why there are not benefits, or are there benefits in making the premiums tax deductible? Because, again, there is an element of paying twice. Thank you.
Yeah. So, okay, let's go back to education for 2 seconds. So I send my child, let's say, to a private school, independent school, and you send your child to Burnside High State School, right? I'm literally paying all those costs, and you are, well, there's a few subsidies, but it's not very much. And you are paying, you are getting everything from the state, so that's fine, we understand the position. When it comes to health, it's not as clear cut as that, because it doesn't matter even if you have the best private health insurance in the world, if you have an accident in your car, on the way or on your bike, on the way home from tonight, they will take you to an accident emergency at Christchurch Hospital. So the state always picks up a decent slug of what's happening in healthcare. Having said that, I actually agree with your fundamental point, which is, look, let's say you have a hip operation, and there's two ways of doing it. One is we ration that through the price or time, right? So we make you wait for a year, in which case, if you go privately, you go straight away and you pick up the cost of that. So yes, there's an advantage in the state having you go privately for some things. So the reason Treasury don't want to do that, and they're the guys who are really opposed, is they say a third of all New Zealanders have private health insurance, and they're going to do it anyway because they don't want to have to wait. So they literally just say, look, we'd be giving what's called a public good, we'd be giving you cash for something you're going to do anyway. Now, what is true is in Australia, they took a slightly different approach. And it's not a bad approach, just to look at it on merits for a moment. What they did was they said, we'll give you a rebate, so a third of your premium is tax deductible. So basically a third back. But what they also said was, so this is the sting in the tail, they said, if you earn over a certain amount of income, and I think it's 50,000 or 60,000, if you don't take private medical insurance, you get a levy applied to you, basically a special tax. And it was that really made people take up private medical insurance. The second thing that happened was, which was a much better bit of their system, they went to the health insurers and they said, we'll do you a deal. If you will agree to this, we'll agree to giving you this rebate, which will encourage people to go and force them to take it if they're high income earners. And that was, they said, you have to provide a whole of life policy. So if I join when I'm 25, the health company, Southern Cross or whatever, has the right to put up my premium by the rate of inflation, health inflation, every year, as they would do, but not to say what happens in New Zealand. So in New Zealand, my premium might be $1,000 if I'm 25 with no kids, but I turn 65, it's $5,000, and I turn 70, and it's $10,000. I just get completely priced out. So we have had some discussions with the health insurers to say, hey, how about you provide us a whole-of-life policy and we'll start looking at whether we can do a deal with you. Now, what stopped all that in its tracks was it cost us money and we didn't have money to give away at that time. But conceptually, we want to keep people in private health insurance at the time they very need it. And the truth of it is, the bulk of your health spending dollars happen in the last 2 or 3 years of your life. And so we want to keep you in that system. So there's some merit in what you're saying, but we've got to work through that and have some financial headroom to do that.
Prime Minister, this is just a question about national standards.
Yep.
With the introduction of national standards, for those children who fall within that normal band, who, you know, with a bit of help and with the teachers obviously teaching to the test, they're going to succeed. For the children who have learning issues, dyslexia, dyspraxia, that sort of thing, with no extra support, those children are going to fail.
Yep.
What are you and your government going to do to support those children who, with a national test, will end up failing without any extra support.
Yeah. Okay, can I just explain for a second on, because you obviously understand it, but a lot of people don't. So this is what we did with national standards, which was basically years 1 to 8. So when your child is 5, going through to when they go to high school, first year of high school, we've implemented a thing called national standards. It is not school cert for 5-year-olds. Okay, so it's not an annual test. We set a standard, and those standards will unquestionably have to be refined. But for instance, as an example, the standard might be, if an average child at age 6 can count from 1 to 10, they will assess your child and say, can you count from 1 to 10? If you can count to 10, then you're at the national standard. If you can count to 20, you're above it. If you can count to 5, you're below it. We don't care what assessment they use. So teachers in the room will know I'm talking about. They'll use lots of standards, STAR, ESTL, PAT. We don't care about whether so much that they're above the national standard or below it entirely either. We care about the progress they're making. So we care about whether they're doing better. In other words, could they read, you know, half a sentence before now they can read a full sentence. So the reason for that is we think that there are a lot of kids with learning difficulties that weren't getting picked up in the system. And what we have done is we've poured a whole lot of money into basically, one, providing support for teachers for national standards, but secondly, for kids that are below the national standard for whatever reason. And in a large part, that may well be learning difficulties. So it's not about saying little Johnny's bad because he can't read to 10 and the average kid can. It's saying little Johnny can't read to 10 and what are we going to do about it? And in the end, the important part of national standards is not just the assessment, it's about communicating that to little Johnny and most importantly, little Johnny's parents. Because in the end, parents want to understand how their children are going and they want to know what they need to do to help them in plain English. And to give you an example of that, in Australia, they went one step further than us. They ranked every school, right, which is what the unions don't like about national standards. They're worried about the media creating league tables and saying, okay, so let's take an example. Burnside Primary is doing really well because most of the kids are above the national standard. And I don't know, let's just pick a school, Wollstone Primary, if there is such a one, is below the national standard. And then they're worried about kids leaving and going from one school to the other. Just to give you an idea of the appetite that parents had for that, they launched that equivalent website in Australia at 3 o'clock in the morning, and it crashed because so many parents went on the site to have a look at it. So what I know is 1 in 5 young New Zealanders leave school with an adequate literacy and numeracy skills, and we have to do something about that. And that means we have to measure their progress, and if they're below the national standard, we have to lift them above it. We'll get them to it as best we can, with the acknowledgement that some kids with learning difficulty reasons or whatever will not reach national standards, I accept that, but not 1 in 5.
Next question for you, Prime Minister. When will you give the Māori language its own essential learning area in English medium schools?
Sorry, one more time.
When will you give the Māori language its own essential learning area in English medium schools? Huh? Right. When does Māori language become an essential part of education?
Oh, when will it become essential? Sorry, Māori language, sorry. Well, look, again, it's about choice. I mean, if you go and have a look at schools today, so when I went to Aorangi Primary, Copland Intermediate and Burnside High School, I have no great memory of learning any te reo, much of a Kapahaka group, all that sort of thing. If you go back to those schools today, we won't go back to Aorangi, but if you go back to the others, although I understand the kids are doing quite well at Burnside Primary, but if you go back to those other schools, then you will find that there's a lot more Māori learning, and you will find that there's a much greater Kapahaka cultural group that a lot of kids are engaged in that. So I don't think we should be forcing it as a mandatory language, but I do think we should be encouraging kids to at least have some basic understanding of Māori language.
Yet your own Minister Tim Grocer disagrees with you, because I remember him saying that in fact if we made Māori compulsory, so every student learned 2 languages when they were at school, the third and the fourth language after that become a lot easier to learn. So in fact you've created an innate skill for learning languages among students.
Yeah, and I think if there is something in that in terms of learning other languages, but I think you've also got to say, you know, how much will you use it? And the answer is a basic knowledge of Māori will be helpful. I'm not saying people shouldn't learn it, obviously they should if they want to, but I think you could equally put up a case that the kid could learn Mandarin or they could learn German or they could learn French. So to me, learning another language is an important skill. Having a basic knowledge of te reo is important, but I don't think it should be compulsory.
Okay, take it over to you. I'll come to you up.
Thank you. What is your government's policy about Māori TV and Freeview 6 and 7 after the current funding runs out?
Yeah, so Māori TV, we have no plans to change the funding there. I mean, it's quite expensive, but it's been reasonably successful, and probably, depending on whether you accept some of the court findings, there's probably an incumbent responsibility on the government of the day to have an extension of knowledge when it comes to the Māori language. So probably the courts would argue we actually need to do some things in that regard, and whether it's Māori radio or Māori television, there's certainly an argument around that. In terms of 6 and 7, and in fact in terms of the whole outlook for television, that is a rapidly changing space. And I can't give you an answer about where that's all going to end up, except what is going to happen is you are moving from basically the existing form of terrestrial television to digital, and that is going to happen in the next few years. It's going to dramatically change a lot of things. But one thing that is happening, and it's having a huge impact on these media companies, is you are doing what's called time-shifting television. So you're here tonight. Whatever's normally on TV on a Wednesday night, and I don't normally get to see TV on Wednesday night, so I can't tell what's good, but whatever it is that you're missing that you want to watch, you're probably MySkying it. And you probably MySky lots of things. And what happens is when you go and watch them, you flick through those ads and don't watch those. And so the world is dramatically changing, and that means you've got lots and lots of TV channels and specific ones, like a History Channel or a Discovery Channel or a CNN channel or whatever it might be. And quite where 6 and 7 fit into those, even where 2 and 1 fit into all those, is something that Television New Zealand itself is debating at the moment. But I suspect it'll shake down with something that's a good product and a good offering. What we do know is that New Zealanders highly value New Zealand product on TV. So I don't think we need a charter to do that, actually, and that's why we scrapped the Television New Zealand charter. But what we do know is that they respond to that, they like it, and the advertisers therefore put their product on there. And whether it's Dancing with the Stars or, you know, I don't know, anything else that's New Zealand made, that's the most popular stuff.
Well, the time's ticking away, so we'll take 3 more questions. Rob, coming up to you if you have one. Up top.
When you came to our state school, Linwood College, before the election, you promised future funding for many of our school's programs, such as the Services Academy.
Yep.
Why have you brought in funding for private schools without fulfilling your promise to increase ours?
Yeah, that's not true. So what's happened is we've actually rolled out about 5 service academies around the country, and the funding to private schools has gone up by about 10 million. And the increase to to public schools has been hundreds of millions. So I can't tell you the exact number, I'd have to go and look it up, but it's in the order of, it will have been in the last 18 months, probably $1 billion increase in the education spending. Those sorts of numbers are just short of $1 billion, and what's gone to private schools has probably been 10 or 20 million.
Search and Surveillance Act and its potential to breach human rights for all New Zealanders?
Yeah, so, okay, I acknowledge the concerns that some people have that the new Search and Surveillance Act could impinge on their human rights. But I guess you've got to ask the question, what's the purpose of the Act? And the answer is to try and get information on those that would commit crimes which could have a significant impact on society. And so it comes to that balancing act between human rights and our need to protect society or to take action against those that would commit, you know, bad crimes. And that includes changes we've been making around, for instance, the proceeds of crime getting much tougher on gangs, trying to break P-labs, all of that sort of stuff. To be successful in that, we have to give the police greater powers. So I, for one, personally am reasonably comfortable with it, because I think that while it moves the balance slightly from where it is today, the benefits of that information in the hands of law enforcement agencies warrant the impact on human rights, but I accept some people don't like that.
And last question from you, your side, Steve.
Hi, John. It's just about the question earlier, just in front of us. You said that you wanted to utilise the secret of the economy that would be dealing with telecommunications and fibre optic networks.
Yeah.
Well, why are there no infrastructure for education in computing and telecommunications areas.
Why are there no what?
Why are there no educational, like tertiary sectors for educating people in those areas?
Oh, okay, yeah. Well, the answer is we wouldn't be opposed if somebody per se wanted to specialise in that, I suppose. They'd have to put up a proposal and the Tertiary Education Commission would have to accept it. But if you go to Canberra University, I'm pretty sure you'll find they're offering a world-class education in computer science. So I'm not sure we need a standalone facility to do that. We just need to make sure our universities have the capability to deliver that offering. And in my experience, Canberra University is right at the top of being universities that is responsive to what the community needs. So very good engineering school, because that's been high demand down here, and it has a very good computer science offering. So I'm not sure we need a standalone facility to do it.
Prime Minister, we've covered a remarkable number of subjects tonight. It's been incredibly broad, so thank you all very much for your questions. If I can propose an aspirational target, to use your words, for this community next year, it's that in the election campaign, rather than having to MySky the typically inept television debates, that we in fact could have you and the opposition leader on stage for a public leaders debate as part of the election campaign. I'd love to see you say yes to that right now.
Yep, I'm happy to do that with the leader of the opposition.
Of course, the cost of that will be GST at 20%. Can I thank a number of people this evening? Obviously, the panel for the first half, Fiona, Colin, and Roger. Can I thank Katie Watkins and the rest of the marketing team for their superb effort in organising tonight? And can I also thank the very clever Texas Christchurch people for the very effective text messaging questions that you've had? Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking the Prime Minister for joining us this evening.